Zach Malone sits so often that he is, of course, John White. Also with us is a native of Cherub City, with her own native Cherub. Actress and singer, she's Ellie Davis. And now, here's your man of the half hour, Skippy Lou.
John White, Santa Ana, California. We're all here.
Right.
I always thought you were in New York. I don't know why, because of
course. Five miles away from 44th Street, so the.
Of course. And Carousel.
Carousel and Pajorica.
That was your first show on Broadway,
right.
Carousel.
Right.
Oklahoma was the one in Chicago.
I did Patrol in Chicago in 44, played about 10 months there.
Tell me about that Oklahoma. How did you get that?
Well, I was out here doing the Rubber Chicken Circuit, as we call it, all the women's clubs and everything.
Uh-huh.
YMCA's and Rotary Clubs and Quarters. I was doing pretty well. I was
right.
And Mrs. Longo, the theater guild, our Marla Marshall,
right.
came out looking for a replacement for Alfred Drake,
uh-huh.
who originated Kurt
right.
Oklahoma. And mine was kind of an interesting interview because my manager called and said, you know, she's on a very tight schedule and your interview will take place in a cab on the way from the hairdressers in Beverly Hills to the Torch Century Fox Studios. So there was one of us on a better plan, by the way, here. And she came out and we got in the cab. She said, how'd you like to come to New York to audition with the one Colonel in Oklahoma? I said, I'd be very excited. She said, well, maybe they'll be hearing from us. But she didn't hear me sing. She just got out of the cab and I went on. And 2 months later, I sent a registered letter from her. I found a pen on to New York. Go back if they didn't like me. And so I decided to be the big break and sold the apartment. I mean, get out the apartment, sold the car. Took a 4.5-day train out to New York. Just go up from the police station to St. James Theater to a song. And I wanted to get around that she had this very unusual for the title girl, or very
right.
tight little book. And at the PMRA, we had a register audition. And registered on the stand over there. And
you had a lot to do in your career, didn't you?
Yeah. And, we'll talk about it. And I had one people in the original cast could say this guy looked like that they brought him to California. And I was very cocky in those days. I'd just done a figure on the Bible Savoy for the market at Music Theater Past in it. So I said, can I warm up? So I said, I'd sell a figure out here from Bobby Seville in English. And it played a big part in the writing of the soliloquy in Carousel later on. But anyway, that's where I got started. They shipped me out to Chicago because they just received the rights from Philip Marlowe to do
Right
Marlowe as our next musical. Felt that I might be a good bit for that medium on in that production role that I had first.
Right.
So that's why I went to Chicago.
But Rodgers and Hammerstein discovered you, really.
The first thing I ever did with Fred Miller to have a semi grand opera was actually Pinafore.
And then MGM signed you up.
Well, I was out there on the phone to make it happen.
Say that, John.
Yeah, I was out having lunch. I said, I just had lunch. He said, can I sing? I said, how did you know? He says, I just had a feeling. Want to get a test?
Really?
So I said, I need a test for a picture, for the film. And they everybody around except Eddie Bazell was brought up in New York. It was his first production as a director.
Right.
So he didn't want to take a new face. So I was put on a 6 month contract. And that's where I got started.
But then you went to New York. Because it wasn't good. You made several others here, though.
I was Lana Turner's chauffeur.
Lana Turner's chauffeur. I love it. I think that's great. And then you went to New York, and that was your bad boy, John White.
Yeah, how about that? Being in those two big shows, and they had an empty seat in the house.
But tell me about Carousel. Opening night.
It was my first night. And we thought we had something because we had done very well in Boston.
Right.
We knew how big we didn't know, and I'm sure we felt that the critics were out with our axes too. Because they were going to do this kind of serious drama as a musical, and we're heading on top of Oklahoma.
Right. Then, Pajama Dean?
Well, I had some about three shows of style out here, sort of. I went back to MGM.
You did go back.
I went back on a contract for a lot of money. And there was no musicals being made, so...
So they just kept you under contract.
Just kept me under contract.
How did you have felt about staying here, not working?
Well, in
such a
staying, we're still staying in voice.
Right.
You know, and working. And then I went on a show called Magdalena, by Ben Harris, at the Civic Art Opera, and lasted about 2.5 months at Broadway. Then a thing called Three Wishes for Johnny, Ralph Brown, score, and lovely music with Al Jeffries.
Great, lovely girl.
About 2.5 months on Broadway. And then a thing called Carmen in Flanders with Dolores Gray.
She's coming here.
Then Dolores won the tournament for just the Five of Flanders we played in New York with that show. Mm-hmm. And then Pajama Game.
Pajama Game, great.
Yeah.
And the living.
The Doors of Night. The Doors of Night.
The Doors Day.
That wonderful night.
Tell me about Doris Day.
Doris was a wonderful guy. She had just gone through some tough problems before we went to work on the picture.
Does she have tough problems at that time?
No. She's just well, you know, if you read a book, you understand. You know,
I didn't read a book. No.
Well, it's kind of a science.
It's a question of science.
Science. You watch your questions.
I also have aim too.
Which helped her out. And she was the only one, of course, and the rest of us were his note, Betty Friday,
right.
And Lady Sharon, Carol Hill, and all of us. We shot that in 5 shooting days, 22 days on the schedule. We started down, must have gotten a pretty good bonus.
You got married, but not to the woman that you really, really fell in love with. There's a wonderful story about John White marrying the same day, the man, the girl that you really wanted to marry.
I married the one of my three children, in Redbound, because Rosemary Kramer, who was of the old Spanish land from Placentia, 3 miles from where I was, went to school in Fulton. We had a terrific, wonderful little family. We grew up on religious grounds. She was Catholic, I was Scotch Presbyterian Protestant. In the West in those days. So I went up to Redlands where I graduated, youngest Redlands, to do the Vagabond King, and Lady Lady was the one chose to marry, and we grew up about 27 years, and that's sort of all I guess. When I got married again to a younger girl, when I came out of here, it's a little stuff of Bella, my daughter.
Right.
Bella, Bella, Bella. And
Lady Lady, who was a rock star,
right?
Well,
yeah,
we'll talk about that. Go ahead.
And so the same thing I introduced me to this lovely girl, Rosemary, in the early years, and the son graduating from Pepperdine at the high school.
Right.
And unbeknownst to me, Rosemary had been a regent at Pepperdine. She still is. And her late husband had passed away about 6 months before this event happened. And I was out having dinner with this friend of mine, and he said, "Hey, John, I was up at Pepperdine the other day, and I'm wearing a Rosemary. And she looks pretty good. I haven't seen her for 9 years.
31 years.
Yeah. So I arranged it for us to get together, and we got married in about 6 months, and it's a marvelous relationship.
That was your love at the beginning.
Yeah, that's right. How lucky
you
man.
Got together at the end.
And the same attraction, the same kind of everything.
Really, John?
Yeah.
You're very happy.
Very happy, very lucky.
Very lucky?
Yeah.
Yes.
Much easier to say.
You're really happy. You seem content.
Much easier to say than so, I'll tell you
that. Is that right?
Yes.
You know, you're singing love songs right now.
Yes,
in a wonderful show right now called South Pacific.
South Pacific.
Oh, that wonderful show. Yes. I always get confused. South Pacific and Oklahoma. Why do I do that, John?
That's all.
Tell me about South Pacific, John White. All about Glendale music.
Glendale Seat, you know, Community College.
Okay.
Wonderful auditorium, wonderful production. As a matter of fact, luckily we have in Southern California, Mr. Jenks out at San Bernardino, at Civic Light Opera, buys up one of the sets. He has several warehouses full of sets out there. This is like the National Company sets that you can get. And it looks very well. It's beautifully made over there. And we have a wonderful company. And, I think perhaps the first quotes star that they've had over there in the 40 years that they've been in
Australia. Really?
Yeah.
How's the turnout?
Turnout's fine. We haven't sold out yet, but it's you don't expect to, I don't think, in that situation.
Well, South Pacific's been around a long time.
Long time.
Long time.
Well,
so
Bob Gray was just in the area with this production of it.
Yeah. But John Waite's bringing his own production, and you have a lady sitting next to you is in the show.
She's in the show. I didn't say anything to her. I took my hat to her.
Yeah, really. She's lovely. I love your voice. Annie Gavis.
Okay.
It's Annie Gavis.
Yes.
And you are from Baltimore, Maryland.
Yes.
And tell me about your career. You're here on the show right now doing South Pacific.
Yes, I play. There's an actual role skipping in the show called Lisa Minnelli. When the director told me the name, I said to him afterwards, did you pick this name? He says, no, it's in the show. And he showed me, it's Lisa Minnelli. I thought, well, that's interesting. Uh-huh. And I'm also understudying Mary, but so far she's been quite well.
We were here last time at the Paso Domingo.
Yeah.
At downtown, at the theater, you did opera.
Yeah, that was wonderful. It was the premier production of the Los Angeles Opera Company, and I did, well, I have it on my resume as Othello, because everyone thinks I spelt it wrong, but it's really Otello.
Uh-huh.
And I played Bianca, and we did it at the Shrine, at Arthur Chandler, and then we went to Houston.
And how was it working with him?
Well, I was with legends. I mean,
You worked with a lot of legends. I understand, and you started. You worked with the Fox Kids.
Which Richard did you say you did first on Broadway?
On Broadway, Carousel.
And I did the revival of Calcutta. You see, it's just the meeting of the names.
And you dance and sing.
Yeah.
Tell me about Annie Gavis. You are doing something about Bonaventure downtown?
Yeah, there's a new club. It's going to be opening the end of March, beginning of April at the Bonaventure, and it's going to be an old supper club type atmosphere.
Right.
It's on the original site of a place called Perino's, and it's supposed to be really fantastic.
Uh-huh.
It's going to have a review, and I'm going to be the premier artist there, so I get to fight with the sound system. It'll be fun.
John, looking back, I mean, you've been around a long time.
Right.
Musical comedy, but you came out of high school. Do you want to be an actor? Do you really want it to be an actor or singer,
singer? I know a few acting singers in my business.
Right.
Most of them are solo actors, and rightfully so.
Yes.
But I came in to the show business as a singer. I was a concert artist.
Yes.
I won my young artist auditions at UCLA, at Miss Hall, at Occidental College, everything before that. But I didn't want to go to opera. I don't particularly like opera.
You're a theater singer.
Yeah.
Good theater singer.
And I've probably done more performances of leading men roles in musicals than any guy living, because I never stopped in 49
years. 49
years. Mm-hmm.
Constantly working.
Mm-hmm.
Looking back.
You said, God rest his soul, Gordon McRae.
Yes.
Radio, pictures, a couple of things. I've had a regional Broadway show, Harry Q.
Yes.
I've had two regional Broadway shows. Didn't last very long.
Looking back over your career, John. Do you have any regrets, or have you left something out? Or Guys and Dolls?
Yeah.
For the show on Broadway?
Yeah.
The film?
No, Broadway. No.
Really?
No, yeah. I had...
What made John Wright turn that part down, John?
I don't know. I didn't think it was right for the time. So it was right after Carousel. I didn't, you know...
It was great songs in Carousel. A great show.
It was one of those things. I guess you're never successful as you turn down. So
tell me about your daughter, Bonnie Raitt.
Well, Bonnie was a wonderful girl, and she was in Radcliffe, a good student. She wanted to be the Margaret Mead of Africa. suddenly she got a call one morning and said, Dad, I just saw a coffee house up in Worcester, Mass. I made $50. Big help. I'm paying $8,000 at that time for help. And the next thing I know, she's playing in small places. She left school and playing at Mainport and Philadelphia and down at the Troubadour.
It's wonderful. She's doing rock and roll.
Yeah.
She's a big star.
Yeah.
She's doing her own. She's followed your footsteps.
But I need to help her because the kids will come up to me and say, I'm related to Bonnie Raitt, and my father said, I look like her.
Annie Gavis, you brought a tape for us today. You sing very well.
Thank you.
I did see you in a live show at the Hilton.
Yes.
And I'd love to see this tape you brought.
It's like a Kenny Mistel song.
Fine.
And it's let's take a look at it.
Can we see?
Sure.
Good. Okay. Roll it. I'm Song in the show at all?
Well, all the girls that are nurses do watch That Man and End in Love with a Wonderful Guy with Nellie and stuff, and if I get a chance to go on, I'll be able to sing both the nurses' parts and the Nellie part, but unfortunately, it's my first time I've understudied, and it's kind of an interesting experience. I get to know them a lot when I'm not on, just go over the lines for myself, because it seems an understudy doesn't really get a chance to rehearse.
Yes. But I thought you did rock and roll, too. Sometimes you do.
Well, not everyone I think like is very not rock. You know, it's more cabaret, more club type of stuff.
John, you said to me just before, you said that of our own company.
A production company had actually got my own gun. I took out I decided I'm going to wear three hats.
It's a different show.
Terrible. Just terrible. I don't think you can do justice to anyone.
So you're one of those actors and performers who are going to be in pictures.
You might be able to go. You can go in and watch the dynamics that I'll do. But not.
But your shows, you know, we're doing that for PBS, is it?
Years ago, there was a fast down. I only had the
Goodyear.
I only had the telephone out. But so they reissued some of those things that I was in, which is kind of great. So I did an ad break, which I'm doing the Matt Douglas show that I did a lot in Mike's Life Theater.
He should be back on. I see my avatar on the tails on Sunday night. I run to him and I say, Mike, please. You have it?
Mike,
please, do a show again. I love him so.
He's fun. A lot of fun.
You don't have Mike to up.
Well, I know the one who was in Cleveland.
He's a good singer. He's a good singer.
Yeah, but I don't know if it's better. I have to get him up with a friend of mine, but I don't know about my bicycle singers.
John, I'm going to ask you, what is your favorite show that you've done?
The favorite show that I've done on the castle, which has been my favorite. But what was probably all that you've done with Ray Martin.
What made Castle your favorite show? Tell me.
Well, I wrote that famous little performance, it's 7.5 minutes long. And when I talked earlier about seeing the figure value when I auditioned, the theater guy said, Dick and Oscar, you've got to give John something as good as that February. And so this was a little bit like that. So I think I promised Sunshine and everything is the soliloquy from Carousel. It was Rodgers and Hammerstein's favorite show.
Some of the favorite ladies you've worked with.
Mary Martin first.
Mary Martin
first.
Everyone says that.
Well, she had a quality to make you feel, as an audience, that you couldn't possibly love her as much as she loves you.
She looked her in the eye.
She could tell if you were going up a little bit, she would protect you. And she's just terrific.
Oh, wonderful.
We had a lot of fun because we recorded Anna Dutch again before we did it, before we rehearsal. Mm-hmm. And I think it's probably some of the best singing she's ever done on albums. And we're going to do a television show following the 16-week run in San Francisco and here in Los Angeles. So it was unusual, and to have that at the end. Yeah. So we took all the sets, put them on Soundstage 2 and 4 of those big studios in Burbank, at NBC. And then we used 2 of the smaller satellites, and we had the orchestra piped in with some of those on camera. We were able to do a 2-hour live presentation of a Broadway musical. Again, I don't think.
John Reed, one-man show you're going to be doing?
The Club of Honest Management, who serves about 750 cities in the United States, approached me about 10 years ago about doing a one-man, like a concert, but not really a concert. Mm-hmm. I don't like concerts. I don't like the idea.
What's the difference between a concert and a...
When I come out of it, I don't have to put the tux on. I don't treat it as a nightclub. I come out and treat the audience as though they were sitting in one other room.
Without a microphone?
Mm-hmm.
No mic.
Most of high school auditoriums.
Wonderful.
In towns like Havre, Montana, or Pascagoula, Mississippi.
I love it.
Over
the audience?
I love it.
So?
I call somebody in the audience, they watch them around from pajama down with this little side. And they do 23 songs for 16 different Broadway shows. I've done it to other anecdotes. I do it from college, basically from when I was in high school in Fulton, doing a desert song in 1934 to the present day.
John Mike, 39 years in show business. Where is it going?
It's going.
I'm talking about you.
I'm sure you're going to write a book.
You're going to write a book?
Well, I've got the
title. Who's writing books?
I've got a title called Kill with Kindness. Did you say kill? If I do it, I have to say, well, you have to read this after I'm gone because of all the goodies. The guys would kill
Did you have no mugs in your eye, John?
Well, I was three, basically.
That's good.
I was so dedicated to my work, and you know, it was really disciplined. I suppose
it's just so John White.
I don't know. I didn't really get into that too much. Not for money.
This will be viewed on John's home, Skippy.
That's all right. Am I happy? Not happy, I should say. That's what I'm going to do show-wise. I think I've done pretty much all the shows. If somebody came around on my rack, I suppose I would, like, on my horse, would grab it, but we haven't as yet.
Can I tell you, this has been a real thrill to be in this production, not only because I get a chance to sleep in my own bed, but because this will be something that I'm going to have in my credits forever, that I've worked with John Wright. And
oh, thank you.
It's really, everyone in the cast feels that way about him, because he's been such a class act.
You seem very happy, Annie Davis, working with this gentleman, because,
It's interesting.
I was seeing you with Chucky Green last time I saw you.
Mm-hmm.
I would love Chucky Green. Now you have John Wright.
And I love you most of all.
Do you know?
Yes.
Yes.
My first comedian that I ever worked with was Skippy Lowe. I thought everybody said Skippy Lowe.
I was working with Skippy up in the mountains.
My first job was a little child.
My first job, yes. First job she got in the business.
And now we're all here in LA.
We're having a good time.
We're having a good time.
John Wright, why don't you sing in the Hammerstein? Who are your favorites?
Well, not my favorites. Paul's also, and because I work so much with him, you know.
Kind of what kind of men were they?
Rather difficult to know. He liked to kind of kids in a different way. And Oscar Hammerstein was a world citizen. He was a federalist, if you know that word for it. And I could tell that by the lyric, you know, he had a lyric South Pacific. He had been taught to hate. What a great opportunity for a composer to have this really sophisticated houses in my heart to be here along this great humanitarian
aspect. Have you met him?
Yeah. I saw this guy.
Have a seat.
This is fun. Corner's beautiful. Way back here in Hollywood, when I auditioned for the master cook with Chris McKay,
right,
back in 1948. And I was at the best of the Messiah Temple in Hollywood, but we had a meeting about. And he came up to me after a song and said, I'm going to tell you, this is the best I've ever heard this song sung. Which was a nice compliment, but that hurt me. I was glad it since then.
Who stars in Hollywood? Was it tough for John Wright in the
Hollywood? Well, because, see, it wasn't. I'm 2 hours of never worked in Hollywood properly. It would have been perfect in those days. You had to be Tommy and Paul and Clay Gables.
Yes.
And if I thought I found out from Robbie Murray that he liked me very much, but some of the producer's wives didn't like me very much. Well, I got, who cares?
Who cares? What was that like?
And when I was there, so Harry Kim was always the competitor. I would go,
was he a competitor?
Sure, he got that one to get you going. Not my test one to get you going, but some of the producer's wife liked his test more than me.
I see.
Then he had to do pajama game, but as they had been playing the gym.
He did.
Right. So he was still, in a sense, competing. They put him together.
He got you.
But you got to do it.
Thanks to him.
Yeah, I love it. Good night.